So in 1999, I read a book called Red Mars by Kim Stanley Robinson. It's about the first 100 settlers on Mars. And while reading that book, I had an epiphany. I became inspired. I realised humans are going to colonise another planet in my lifetime. That is going to be the biggest thing that ever happens during my life. So I decided I was somehow going to be involved in that. So for about 15 years now, I've been participating in the worldwide Mars community and working on ideas for human settlement of Mars. So why Mars? Mars is a planet most like Earth. The length of its day is just 24 hours and 40 minutes. It has seasons, weather, it has water, carbon, nitrogen, metals, everything that's needed for life and for technological civilization. Mars has solar, wind, and geothermal energy. It's very close, and we know a lot about it. So Mars is by far our best target for space settlement. And space settlement is essential for the future of humanity. What we're seeing at the moment is the emergence of new space technology, which is both cheaper and more advanced than anything we've had before. And this makes it possible to design new and better space missions. So what I've been doing for about the past year is putting together a plan for a new humans to Mars mission based on this latest technology. One of the companies doing really interesting things is SpaceX. They're working on a new family of rockets called Falcon, and you can see here a Falcon 9 launching. So far, 8 of these have flown. The Falcon 9 Heavy will start flying later this year, and it's going to be the most powerful rocket available and able to deliver up to about 13 tons to the surface of Mars. Following these will be the Falcon X and Falcon X Heavy rockets. These are designed for Mars. The Falcon X Heavy will be able to deliver payloads of up to about 30 tons to the surface of Mars, and this is what we need for human missions. NASA are also working on a vehicle also for Mars of a similar scale, but the big difference is SpaceX are making their rockets reusable. This is going to bring down the cost of launching anything into space by a factor of about 100. SpaceX have also developed this capsule called a Dragon. The Dragon capsule became, in 2012, the first ever commercial spacecraft to dock with the International Space Station, or ISS, and it's now regularly used for cargo transport to and from the ISS. SpaceX have also developed a crewed version of the capsule called a Dragon Rider. These have capacity for up to 7 astronauts, and starting later this year or early next year, these capsules will be used to transport crews to and from the ISS. Now, like all space capsules to date, these are designed to splash down in water. But SpaceX are currently working on a version of the Dragon that can land on solid ground. That saves the time and the cost associated with a water recovery, but more importantly, it means the capsules can land on other worlds with solid surfaces, such as the Moon or Mars. So NASA and SpaceX have already begun developing this concept for Mars. It's called Red Dragon. These capsules will be able to deliver payloads of up to about 2 tons to the surface of Mars with pinpoint accuracy and at a much lower cost than existing landing systems. Already, some robotic missions are being planned using these capsules. They can also be used in human missions to deliver cargo or, in the Dragon Rider configuration, crews of up to 7 astronauts on Mars. This is a BA-330 inflatable space habitat currently being developed by Bigelow Aerospace. These have a built-in life support for up to 6 people. They can be used in space or on the surface of the Moon or Mars. Compared with a space station module, they have significantly lower density, but they actually provide a superior protection from the space environment. And this is a biosuit currently in development at MIT. This is the next generation of spacesuit. It's called a mechanical counterpressure spacesuit. Our existing spacesuits are called gas pressurized spacesuits. They're very bulky, they're very hard work, they're hard to move around in, hard to do useful things. The gloves in particular are like squeezing a tennis ball, so the astronauts can't spend a lot of time using them. Also, they provide a very low air pressure to the astronauts. That means they need to spend a couple of hours pre-breathing before a spacewalk so they don't get decompression sickness. These new spacesuits are skin tight, like a diver's wetsuit. They're much easier to move around in, they're much more comfortable. They also provide a higher air pressure to the astronauts so they don't need to pre-breathe. That saves a lot of time. So these suits enable the astronauts to work outside more often for longer periods, do more useful work and be more comfortable. So these are the kind of suits we need for Mars because the missions are very long and there's an emphasis on outside work. What I'm going to do now is take you to Mars and back in 5 minutes. This is what we call a bat chart. Okay, this is a way of graphically describing a space mission. So on the left, we see Earth in the blue. On the right, we see Mars in red. And you can see rockets being launched from Earth and hardware being delivered to the surface of Mars. In this schedule, we start in 2031 with a pre-deployment phase. This is where we send all the hardware out to Mars in advance of the human crew. This is done for safety. So we can remotely activate and test that gear, make sure that it's all working properly before the crew even leave Earth. One of the most important things we send is the Mars Ascent Vehicle, also called a MAV. This is the vehicle that will carry the crew from the surface of Mars to Mars orbit at the end of the surface mission. Now, the MAV has this really interesting feature. It makes its own propellant. So the MAV will bring with it a few tons of hydrogen from Earth, react it with carbon dioxide from the Martian atmosphere, and make methane and oxygen, and this is a really good rocket fuel. The reason we do this is so the MAV can be launched on Mars, or landed on Mars, unfueled. That makes it much lighter and easier to land on Mars. We also send a surface habitat. This is one of the BA-330 modules. As I said, these have life support for 6 people, so even though a Dragon Rider capsule can carry 7, we designed this mission for a crew of 6. We send a pressurised rover. This is for exploring around the base. Additional cargo and supplies can be landed in the Red Dragon capsules. And the first mission, we also send a dedicated satellite and position that in a stationary orbit above the base. The next thing we do is we build the ship that's going to carry the crew out to Mars and back. We call this the Mars Transfer Vehicle. This requires several launches. The vehicle is assembled on Earth orbit. It's comprised of a transit hab plus some large fuel tanks and rocket engines. The transit habitat is another one of the BA-330 modules. So why do we use the same habitat technology in space as we use on Mars? The reason is commonality of hardware. It's fewer systems that the crew needs to learn and understand. So if they can fix something in the transit habitat, they'll also be able to fix it in the surface habitat. In 2033, we send the crew. So we started in 2031. So there's a 2-year gap between the pre-deployment and sending the crew. And this is because Earth and Mars line up in their orbits roughly every 2 years. This is why we typically see Mars missions being sent on this 2-year cycle. So we launch a Falcon 9 rocket from Earth with a Dragon Rider capsule carrying the 6 crew. This capsule docks with the Mars Transfer Vehicle and the crew will enter the transit hab, and that'll be their home for the trip to Mars, which takes around about 6 months. That capsule will remain docked to the Mars Transfer Vehicle en route to Mars. On arrival at Mars, the spaceship will park on Mars orbit. The crew will get back into that capsule and use that to land safely on the surface of Mars. Now, we don't land right near the habitat. The reason for that is when one of these capsules lands, the thrusters will kick up a lot of dust and dirt, and we don't want to damage any of the hab systems or cover the solar panels in dirt, so we'll land at least a few hundred metres away from the surface hab. The crew will be wearing their biosuits, but we won't expect them to walk to the habitat because they've just been in space for 6 months. So what we do is we pick them up in the rover. That rover can be remotely driven to the capsule. The crew transfer from the capsule into the rover, and then they drive to the surface hab. The crew spend 1.5 years on the surface of Mars doing science and exploration. By that time, Earth and Mars have lined up again, and it's time to come back to Earth. So again, wearing their biosuits, the crew will drive the rover out to the MAV. The MAV will also be located at least a few hundred metres from the hab for the same reason. When it launches, we don't want to damage the habitat. So in the top of the MAV, we have a second Dragon Rider capsule. The crew transfer from the rover into this capsule, and then the rover is remotely driven away back to the surface habitat. Again, for the same reason. We don't want that rover affected by the launch of the MAV. The upper section of the MAV launches. We call this the ascent stage. It leaves behind the descent stage, which includes the propellant factory and power systems, and we do that to reduce the amount of mass that needs to be launched from Mars. On arrival at Mars orbit, that capsule will dock with the Mars transfer vehicle again, and the crew will transfer back into that transit hab. That capsule is then undocked and discarded. So that may seem a bit odd. Why would we waste the capsule? Why not use that to land back on Earth? There's 3 reasons why we do that. One is that capsule's been on Mars 44 months and it could be contaminated. We don't know there's not life on Mars, so we can't risk bringing that capsule back into Earth's environment. Another reason is if that capsule's not needed for a landing, it means it doesn't need a heat shield or thrusters or fuel. That makes it much lighter and therefore much easier to launch from Mars. Thirdly, without the capsule attached to the Mars Transfer Vehicle, it means we don't require quite as much fuel to get back to Earth. So again, it takes around 6 months to get back. The Mars Transfer Vehicle will park on Earth orbit, and then another Falcon 9 rocket is launched from Earth carrying an empty Dragon Rider capsule. This capsule will dock with the transit hab, and the crew will use that capsule to land safely on Earth. Now, the concept here is to run multiple missions to a single location on Mars and build up a base. This is in contrast to Apollo, where we visited a different location on each mission. That's good for science, but not so much for settlement. And for Mars, that approach is far too expensive. The missions are much longer and we require a lot more hardware. So instead, we focus on one location. This is both cheaper and also safer. It means that we can have, for example, redundant backup hardware at the base, like a spare habitat. It means we can position a dedicated satellite above the base, and it means we can land crews on Mars in capsules rather than in habitats, and that's a lot safer. The key feature of this plan is affordability. We use commercial hardware that saves on development costs. We use reusable rockets. We reuse the base for multiple missions. We can reuse the Mars transfer vehicles. By keeping the cost low, it means more countries can get involved. It's easier to raise money. It means more missions can be run. The base can be operated for longer. We can establish a permanent human presence on Mars. The concept for the base is the International Mars Research Station. And as the name suggests, this is inspired by two existing programs. One is the International Space Station. This has been permanently inhabited for 14 years. 75 missions have been run to the ISS, and it's been developed by a consortium of five space agencies. So it's been tremendously successful in terms of science as well as international collaboration. The Mars Analog Research Stations are operated by the Mars Society. We have one in North Canada in the Arctic. There's another one in the desert in Utah, and we may soon see a third in South Australia. So far, more than 150 simulated human missions have been conducted at these stations by researchers from all over the world. So they've delivered tremendous insight into what a human mission to Mars will be like. We're about to run a full one-year simulation in the Arctic. This is the Mars Arctic Research Station here. This simulation is something that's never been done before. And I just want to show you at the top there, there's a red, green and blue flag. This is the flag of Mars. My dream for the IMRS is that it be developed by a consortium of 10 space agencies. These would be the five ISS partners plus five new partners. All of these countries will have human spaceflight capability by about 2020. All of them will be able to participate in this plan and send their own astronauts to Mars. There's a crucial benefit to taking this approach. These are, effectively, the leading nations of Earth. Can you imagine what it would mean for the leading countries of Earth to all work together on something as incredibly important and historical as opening up a new world for human civilization? What could that mean for world peace? So this is an emblem concept for the IMRS. It simply shows the planet Mars with 12 flags around it. 10 of these are for the international partners. At the top, we see that flag of Mars. This is intended to show we're not going to Mars just to visit, but we're going there to stay. We're creating a new branch of human civilization. At the bottom, we have the flag of Earth. This symbolizes that we're not going to Mars purely as a group of countries, but as a unified people. We're doing this for the benefit of all humanity, in peace for all humanity. And that's the attitude that we should have when opening up a new planet. Becoming a multi-planetary species represents a quantum leap in our evolution. It is without doubt one of the most important things to ever happen in human history and will positively transform every aspect of human society. With the new space technology currently becoming available, this plan is extremely achievable. We can start working on it straight away and we can open up a whole new planet while also making things better on this planet. Thank you very much.